Hello everybody. Thank you for joining today's Bootstrap session, where we'll be presenting TCS's Location Toolkit Web Services, also known as LWS. I am Brian Uriosti, Engineering Director for some backend services here in TCS's Applications Group. And with me, I have Todd Ornette, Staff Web Engineer, and he's leading our Web Services team. Say hi, Todd.
Hi, everybody.
We have about an hour to go over everything, which should be plenty of time. So let me get items all shared here. I'm now the presenter. I want to make sure that everything's synced up, and then we'll be good to go. Okay, so Location Toolkit Web Services. So what is it? It is our RESTful web services that are for doing very popular location-based services. We have mapping. You can get a route between two points and get directions to those locations. You can search for points of interest and address, kind of like a single search box. Imagine you can want to type in a category or of place or a business name or just an address. You can get results for that around a location, which searching for addresses, also geocoding, and also support reverse geocoding, where you're converting a lat-long coordinate pair to an address. So for example, if you drop a pin on a map, you want to know the address of that. Very useful for like a where am I solution or something, a feature. All of our endpoints support XML and JSON. And we're also secured via SSL, so make sure you're using HTTPS. We have the credentials are a partner ID and an API key, which will be provided in a moment. They'll also be provided in an email. If you send me out an email, we'll cover that a little bit more in detail along the way, and they'll be available at the show as well, or at the hackathon. We have an online documentation and test tools via our portal, which we will be going over in momentarily. So why use it? Aside from all the cool features and functionality you can do, TCS is also sponsoring an accelerator prize of $5,000, and that will be awarded to the best app integrating LWS. We will have a judge from TCS there, and we'll be determining who gets the top honors there in that $5,000. So talking about our endpoints, they're one of the endpoints, this is getting into some more of the details of the API now. We have a map endpoint, which supports both tile maps and static maps. There are actually two separate endpoints here. We'll cover that when we look a little bit more detail about those. Like I mentioned before, we have a search, which includes POIs and addresses. There's also a suggestions endpoint that you can use to get results as you type. So you can be typing, let's say you're typing P-I-Z, and you'll get search results that come up for pizza can be responded. And you'll get those in the replies as your suggestions. Route, which you can get a route between two points, which is really a superset of routing functionality. I'll cover that in more detail here in a second. Directions, which is really a subset of route. It's there just for simplicity's sake, but it's really the same stuff. Reverse geocode API, that is mentioned as before, is to convert a lat long into an address to see where you are. So here's the link to the portal. This link is also available in the place where you signed up for the WebEx in here. So we're going to take a look at that really quickly. I'll be jumping back and forth between this and Chrome as we go through some of these items. So here's the landing page for our Location Toolkit Web Services API. And here you can see all the APIs on the left side here. So basically, if you read through this, parse through it, you'll see that you need a partner ID and an API key. So I'll go grab those. So let's say we wanted to do like a search request. Each of the APIs, they have a description of what you can do with them here, talk about the methods supported, the types, response types that you can request, the request format, and then it gets into the details. So for all the parameters that can be provided, for search, the search term, where you're searching around, filter, which is optional, not used. Some types, and a lot of these things are, optional, well-supported, but optional. And we talk about the response down here. There's an example in JSON and XML that can be exploded out here, and you can also use this live test tool to play with responses. So we'll go through some of those here. So on first go through, you need to, you know, we're going to populate our partner ID here that you'll receive. And so we plug that in here. Now this search request, this is looking like it's searching for grocery as a search term. So just as a quick example, you send a response and then you get a bunch of results here relating to grocery stores, Pacific Park Market, and you get some categories and phones, things like that. So that's kind of the gist. As you can go through each of these, then when you're going through these, the partner ID and the API key will be persisted for anything future. That's all stored locally there. So, but any troubles at all, any problems, any questions, any issues, this is the support email to get back to us at. So it's LTK, which stands for the Location Toolkit, which is the umbrella set of toolkit where our web services falls under. This LTK-support@telecomsys.com is where you can get more information on anything there. So some sample requests, if we want to take a look at those here, I just did the one for grocery near that location. This is specifying that you want the response to be in JSON. You're specifying the search API. Here's your search center. Here's the query. And then simply your API key and your partner ID. So we can click on that to try it. And it should have fired up this here. And this, you can see, very similar to the results we just got. If you wanted to see one like this car route here, so for example, we'll go into this in more detail. But you see here that we're requesting a JSON response. Here's a route request. We're going from this point to this point, our destination. We'd like that to be done fastest route possible, meaning the fastest speed. It's for a car vehicle, not for walking directions. We want to avoid HOV lanes, driving by myself, traffic alert, audio support, and different things like that are specified in the API. But clicking on it to try it, and then we get a response back. All the details for this will be in the API, and we'll talk a little bit more about those in a few minutes. So talking about mapping, so what I'm going to go through now is I'll go through each of the endpoints, each of the APIs. Then I'll be trying them out in the portal. And as well as we also have a relatively quick and dirty sample application where we mash these things up together to create an application for it, and where we can kind of see them in a working example, maybe to give ideas of what you might be doing with your applications, things like that. So in our tile map service, this is our map endpoint. I'll go through details of that in a second when I bounce over to the portal. But here we're rendering tiled map images on the fly as pings. We use a standard web Mercator projection with XYZ tile map coordinate system. So this is very standard. You can use this service directly with plugins like web plugin or Leaflet, which is a toolkit for mapping. Very popular to create web applications and use any tile service like ours to do that. You just if you have questions on Leaflet or anything like that, feel free to shoot an email over. We can help, but if you just search for Leaflet in Google, you'll see it, and it's very they have really good documentation, a quick start guide, and there's a whole slew of plugins to do different location-based things that are quite cool. So you can get a lot of that content from us and then drop it right into Leaflet, using Leaflet to get that rendered on a map and you know, interactive. If you have, let's say, HTML5 application or something like that. So let's take a look at that now. This is our tiled map service here. And so bouncing back, this is our map tile. So here, the authentication that I mentioned before about the partner ID and the actual API key, that's actually not supported in this one API. So all the other APIs support it. This one does not, so you're free to do whatever you want without anybody tracking you. But no, really, it's just not supported to do any type of limiting or authentication or anything as well. We have a big, nice cache here sitting in front of that, and so, you know, things work pretty well here. So anyways, if we wanted to take a look at this, you could take a request here. We have one kind of pre-populated. You can send a request, and here's the actual URL that gets sent. Here it's asking for the map, locale here being English, US. version 1.0, doesn't matter so much. The format is ping. Ping's the only one really supported at the time. Resolution 192. The resolution here mainly controls how big a font you're going to get back. And here using the XYZ coordinate system as well as the size of the actual tile that you're getting back. So 192, so for the X, 9915, Y, 12119, Z, 15, zoom level 15. So if you wanted to, you know, play with that, we can change that all around. You can build this. Again, this plugs right into Leaflet. Leaflet already has all the libraries and everything for doing the math for how to render these things quickly. And pressed for time, like in a hackathon, you know, scenario, that's where you would, you know, look to make use of this library there. Unless you already have all the libraries in another friendly format where you can drop these in and do that. So, give an example there. Let me bring up our TCS Maps application. So this is the app that is the, you know, the mashup of all the LWS services here that we can, you know, go through, and you can see all these tiled maps being rendered, you know, on the fly with the cache. I should have pre-populated some of this, but you can see the mapping here happening. Taking a look at our tools. Do you want to get a sense of what's being done behind the scenes? You know, you can fire up the developer tools and take a look at all the requests as they go out. Take a look at all the URLs here and see everything that's, you know, happening under the hood. So it's pretty, you know, as far as map tiles go, it's, you know, straightforward stuff. Okay. So now we also have, let's say you don't want the tile map service. Let's say you don't want to deal with, you know, all those different zoom levels and everything like that. And you just need a static image of an arbitrary size, and you just want that image back. Well, that's what we have a static maps API for. To show an example of that, that is our other map endpoint. So taking a look over here, if you go to the map endpoint here, this one, we support the parameters of the center location as well as the scale. This is the scale of the map in the meters per pixel. You have your height and your width, and then your you know, your dots per inch or your pixels per inch. That helps specify the resolution of how you want the fonts back. So pre-populated example one here, right here with the partner ID and everything, then we get our map image, looks like that. Let's say we want the height to be 512 instead. Well, that's kind of dumb, but let's say we wanted the width to be 512, for example. We can send that request, that should work. There you go. Let's say we wanted to zoom that out a little bit, our scale to be more like 40 meters per pixel instead, then we would get something like that as we start to zoom out. I think we can play with this. Mm-hmm. So if we change with our DPI, change that to 200 dots per inch, you might have this fonts might be smaller. For higher resolution devices, you know, fonts might be a little bit larger. So you see something like that. So here's a request for maps. You can you know, create static maps on the fly, and that returns back in the format provided. There's no XML wrapper for is there an XML wrapper for this one, Todd?
No, not really.
Okay,
no.
So the ping is returned directly on that
yep.
one. Okay, great. That covers mapping. Next, we're going to move on into search. So we have our search APIs here. That's single search for looking for POIs and addresses. Also have support for POI only or address only if you're interested in doing just that. The relevance of what's returned is based on the text match as well as the location of interest. So being location-based, there's a center, a search center on everything. It factors highly into the relevance of what's returned. So some of the search use cases for the points of interest, for example, you can type in Dodger Stadium, you can say Spago in Las Vegas, you can add, you know, it supports separator words like this to help identify the location reference. So it would be search term near Las Vegas or search term near whatever city, state, postal code, those areas in there. You can also ask for categories, pizza, airport, coffee shops, and flowers. There's, you know, literally hundreds of them. And then you can also have category and location reference, florists in Las Vegas, things like that. We also support higher level admin levels for addressing. You can just search for Los Angeles or a zip code or a state or, you know, anything on high level at that. As far as more for address use cases, you know, you can enter the whole address in. You can add commas in where they go, which is always helpful and adds a little hint. But you can do partial searches of addresses with just the city, or partial of the address with a postal code without a street number, also if you're just looking for a street. And then you can do just position assisted. So you may just say, well, give me the nearest 6th Liberty and here's my lat long. That's supported as well. Also support airport searches for people on the go and things, traveling, airports, very high use case. So these search terms are prioritized and bumped up, and they all work. So you're searching for airport codes, or maybe you're searching for a city plus airport. So you just want the, and that'll just return like LAX or airports in and around Los Angeles. So taking a look over at the API for that, we have search here, and some of the parameters for search include our search center. This is the center of the search. This will be required, as well as a search term, something to search for. So you enter your lat long as well as a term, and you'll get results back. You can also specify the user position. This will identify the distance to return. Otherwise, it's the distance for the search center. You could specify single searches, you know, usually the highest use case. If you had a case where you just wanted an address, you could search for address only, or airports only, or POI only. Airports are often considered POI and always supported, so an address only search sometimes might return airports too. But if you really only want an airport and you knew that, you could, you know, target airports only. So iterator length, the number of objects you want in your page of views, a page of data, page of results, and then you can, you know, start from the first page and say, give me the next page, give me the next page, and all that's controlled with this iterator here, which is this opaque value that you know, just include in this little cookie. So if you're asking for the next page of results, make sure you're including this cookie here, because in it is embedded, you know, where you are in your search. Also a radius to cut off results if you're interested in that. As far as the response goes, you'll get back a list of categories for a given place, the distance to that location, and then the location of that item. So you get an array of all of these for each result, and they'll be ordered by most relevant to and on. You also get a phone number for them. So if we want to take a look at one, let's say we wanted to do, what did we say? It was, what's it, Spago?
Spago.
In Las Vegas. That works. Hopefully there's a Spago there. Yes, great. Okay. So Spago in Las Vegas. The distance looks to be quite far from us. So 368 kilometers from our search center. That's what we specified. We didn't change our search center. And so you get the address to Spago. What's next? Another Spago. Take one there. Oh, and then you get Spago Lane, so you get an actual address there. And then you get Spago in Beverly Hills, so you start to get things farther and farther away. So you can have a radius filter on that to filter out things if you're just looking for things in a certain location. Otherwise, since Spago is a direct hit and direct match, it will be returning other ones. And, you know, this one in this case is in Beverly Hills. So it's a way to get there's a lot of content sitting behind these APIs, and you can embed that into your application to have users getting at relevant things to do, places to go, things like that. Let's see. And then suggestions. This is another endpoint of ours, and the idea here for suggestions is you may have a user interface where people are typing in results and where you want to suggest results back to them quickly as they type in. So, you know, kind of like the instant. typing in like P or PI or PIZ, you know, you're going to get pizza first. Users, when they type in P, are often looking for pizza. There are indexes and keys based on the number of letters and the number of phrases and the different phrases they can enter that help power this, based on what users do on a daily basis. We have a whole lot of requests and a whole lot of data, and all that data of what people are doing and looking for is helps power our indexes to make suggestions based on what people are looking for in given different areas. So here we have it full of different data corpuses. We have POIs, street addresses, categories. These can all be entered, and these are all entered into our indexes. We have regional and national brands, the airports, landmarks, cities, and they're ranked by population, popularity, and proximity. So that if you have, like, you know, Springfield, Illinois might be returned before, you know, Springfield, California, if there is one. I don't know. States and postal codes, things like that. So taking a look over at the API there, so suggestions. So here you enter search center, country, default is USA, no need to change that. It's very helpful on the suggestion side for global applications and a query. Here, their search term that we entered. From here, you get things back a little differently than you did previously. Here, it's more for visual representation, so you just get these lines of text for display. You'll get a distance to that item, but as well as line 1, line 2, line 3, and then a search filter, which is again like an opaque value that you'll be putting into a search request. So let's say you got a suggestion back, you started typing in P, and you got Pizza Hut back, and the Pizza Hut had an address to it, and you may push on that Pizza Hut, and it'll return you back that one that the user selected. You may also get Pizza Hut as a brand being returned. And in that case, if you push Pizza Hut brand, you know, for that item, and you do a subsequent search with that search filter filled in for the search API, you would get back a list of POIs that have been identified as, you know, belonging to the Pizza Hut brand. In other words, Pizza Hut stores in that chain. So let's see if we can see this at work. Let me do PI. Hopefully, it better be pizza. Okay, good. So we get pizza here. Also, we got a Pico Rivera in case the user was going to Pico Rivera. So again, this is by location. So then there are line 1 pizza, line 1 so Pico Rivera, line 1 Pittsburgh, California, line 3, so then this person came up in our POIs, so they must be entered into one of our databases for whatever reason, probably a store or something like that. So anyways, you get POI results based on that. Usually we only show the first 3 in any application for suggestions, and that's kind of common to do. Other queries, let me try sub. So sub, you see here, you get a subway stations, another subway at this location. This, excuse me, so this subway would represent the brand. And with this search filter, which is a whole bunch of data that you send over to tell it that effectively it's the brand. Then another one, you have subway stations, which is another category type. And then you know, specifically, there's the nearest subway to where, you know, we are to that search center. So three results come back, or actually a lot more results, suggested only the first 3, depending on your application. But you can use those, make another search request, and then you'll get the exact results we're looking for through search, where you get all that other place information, the phone number, the category, the address, the lat long, all those other items. So that's the way suggestions works. Let's bounce back to the presentation here. Moving on to the area of routing. So this is for routing and directions. Now, directions is that subset API that doesn't have as much information as routing. No real benefit to using it. You can just ignore what comes back in routing, but I'll talk about directions first, and then we'll look at routing afterwards in that detail. So directions returns a set of maneuvers between 2 points. It supports different route styles. Maybe you might be familiar with navigation systems. You can do fastest, shortest, easiest. These are some of the most popular. navigation route styles. Different vehicles are supported for car, truck, bicycle, and pedestrian. So for example, if you do pedestrian, we're not gonna route you onto a highway. If you do a truck, we're not gonna route you onto roads that, you know, have truck restrictions on them and things like that, and same with bicycle. So it's really by the vehicle type of what's allowed and not allowed, depending on the map data and what's prohibited in the actual data. Also support avoids. You can avoid HOV lanes or carpool lanes. You could avoid highway if that was, you know, something you needed to do or desired, didn't want to take the highway to get somewhere. U-turns, unpaved roads, ferries, you know, you can avoid those things. So let's take a look over at that API. So directions here. So you need an origin and destination to get anywhere. You can optimize, this is that route style I was mentioning. Fastest is the default, if you specify it, great. If you want shortest or easiest, otherwise, you know, you can leave it off. What type of vehicle and then what to avoid. So a very, you know, straightforward API to use from this here. And then afterward, you have the destination. You get a list of maneuvers back. So this is where all the heavy lifting is done on parsing of that information. The origin, so this is the place, your origin. So this is just takes that lat long and figures out where that is. That's from an address perspective, if that's useful. The route extents, in case you wanted to then in turn draw this on a map and figure out what the span of that. So this would be the bounding box for that route. And then you also get a route ID, which is could be useful for other APIs in the future. But so we wanted to, well, let's take a look at this at work here. So I want to get a route and just what's the default. I don't think this is going very far, but I'll do it anyway, just give you an idea of what it is. So we, here we have a destination. We're saying this is the coordinate destination. Here's our origin. Everything's in Aliso Viejo and weighted that way because that's where we physically are. But so we're getting a route between those two points. We get our route ID back, and then you start getting your list of maneuvers. And again, this is where all that the heavy lifting is needed to go over this. So total length gives you the whole length of the whole route. Here's that the extents of that of the, all the maneuvers. That bounding box that was mentioned. Yeah, let me make sure that's right. Yeah. And then you start getting into the individual commands. Oh, let's see. Oh, there's the route extents. Yeah, those are the route extents here. And this is for individual maneuvers. So first maneuver here, this is a list of maneuvers. First maneuver, the length of that first maneuver is this many meters. Here's the bounds of that maneuver, in case you wanted to draw just that maneuver, actually. The command set here, which I'll talk a little bit more here, this command says turn left at this point, and it's in this distance till the next one. The heading, the general direction that they'll be heading. So the max instruction distance, these are for the navigation purposes of when you might want to say what are, announce something. The speed for that maneuver is stack advised, meaning should you say, okay, you have the next maneuver coming up, and then your current road info, I'm on Liberty, then here's all the segments, and this is where you start getting the route line if you wanted that path through for the maneuvers here. So you have a lat, you have a long, you have a length, and then you have a direction of that. Then that's repeats, you know, for all this until you have a complete polyline that represents that exact maneuver and all the road segments in between. Your turn road info, this is where you'll be turning next, so you'll be turning at Aliso Creek. So if we read this here, it will be, you're on Liberty, turn left on to Aliso Creek. We're in the USA and your driving side's on the right side of the road, by the way. Moving on to the next maneuver, total length of that one, this many meters, you know, so it's kind of a repeat. So yeah, this one doesn't go very far at all. The DT is a destination. It says your destination is here, the distance ahead there. Where you're going to announce, you know, you might want to announce or give thing. This is more for turn-by-turn navigation. The overall speed for that entire, for this entire maneuver, it's in meters per second. And so then you're on Aliso Creek Road. Here's all the segments that make up and give you the route across the map data all the way to your destination. And finally, you're done at the end here when you get this last destination point. So this represents getting a route between two points. Do see that if you were going to present users with some directions, maneuver directions, commands, you will have to build out your own string to do so. There is a list if you look at the API here, and I just got to that by clicking this here to see the maneuver commands list for details. Here are all the maneuver commands that are supported that will be returned back. That will need, you would have to, you know, code in case you wanted to translate these into human, you know, readable instructions. So take an escalator, enter country, cross the bridge, enter the ramp. I mentioned the turns before here. So it's turn left, turn right, slight left, slight right, hard left, hard right. Those are all supported here. It's so the turn is your general command, and all these qualifiers here are on the direction you're going. So any questions on this, we'll be around to help support at the venue and via email. So we can, you know, definitely help with these items here. So that covers directions. Let's see about routing, which is just has a little bit more information coming back with it. Like before, you do get the maneuvers, you get that route geometry that you can build, and then you also get some real-time and historical traffic flow info. This is where you can get some the traffic information for your route while you're along it. It's geared towards more turn-by-turn navigation applications, just because of that traffic piece. There's some other items I'm kind of going to cover here as well, and so we also support traffic-based routing. Let's say you wanted to, instead of just giving me the fastest route based on, you know, what I understand of that from our map data, well, maybe we want to consider real-time traffic information in that, and this is the API that helps with that. You can get a route polyline that returns traffic information. So this is a little more involved, and so we've kind of separated it out to a separate API, but so it's really a superset of what we have in directions. So with that, looking at route here, similar parameters, origin, destination, optimize, the vehicle type you're going to use, the avoid, what you want to avoid. You have some pronunciation styles for if you want to get some audio data back. You may want that AMR format if you're going to play it on, you know, Android-like phones, AAC for iPhone, devices that support these. The traffic level, if you don't want traffic considered at all, you would, you know, set this to none. If you would like to avoid your route to have consider real-time traffic speeds, then you would say avoid. So saying I want to use traffic information to avoid routes when calculating the route. So you would set that to here. Alert, this is used for clients that support another polling. It's not, you know, really applicable here. All you get with this is that you won't get a route that uses traffic information to calculate your route, but you will get traffic information. So that's really what this means. It means you'll respond back to the client with real-time traffic speeds, but you will get the same route you, you know and love, let's say, between two points. Like if you're routing home, I don't want it to take me down every side road because that happened might be faster. I kind of just want to know what the ETA will be for that, for the route I usually take. So don't consider real-time traffic to calculate the path, but let me know what, you know, use real-time traffic to calculate the travel time. So that's what this is for, and this is, you know, definitely the most popular usage of traffic in the APIs. Audio support, if you wanted to get some items back to announce road names, you know, usually we set this to off, but there are other items supported here. Destination, like before, similar, so I won't cover that. The maneuver here, very similar. Command, coordinate, current road info, you can, you know, reference all of this. The audio URL I mentioned for the audio. Distance, heading, stack advice, cover some of that. Polyline, the segment, covered that. Speed, traffic regions, I'll cover the, I'll be talking mostly about the traffic region for the next couple of moments. Origin like above, route extent similar to above, traffic ID, route ID, and then the traffic flow. So the real difference in this whole API is really the traffic flow and the audio items, and it's meant for turn-by-turn applications and GPS applications. So let's take another look at this. I think these are the same points that we used previously. We can take a look at the differences here. So we get a session ID. We're routing between two points. We got our route extents again. We have our maneuvers, and this is starts the maneuver list. We get a turn right. That's what we got before, I believe. And as we go through, we're starting out on Liberty Road. We have some audio URLs here that will should announce Liberty. We have then you start getting all the segments for that. Let's see, is there any traffic information yet? No. So like before, our polylines here, and then we have our traffic regions. So this is basically saying this maneuver has these traffic regions in it. Here's an ID for a traffic region. It's going to start at 00 in the maneuver and go to this length. If we took a look at the length of this maneuver, it's actually 813 meters, and this length of this traffic region is 813 meters. So that means this whole maneuver only has one traffic region in it, and that'll come into play here in a minute. Then we have our turn road info, and for that, and then we have some more audio associated with that road name. So anytime we have a road name, there's audio that can be retrieved for that. So then we go on to the next maneuver. We have total length, that there. So for this maneuver, total length here, here we're going to be turning left to get there, turning left on, well, from Aliso Viejo Parkway to wherever we're going. Here's our road segments. This one, our traffic regions here, and our length is that. So it's the ID of our traffic region. Then we go there. Then the next maneuver is a little bit longer. This is where we're going to, our last point there, we're going to arrive there on this item. Again, segments. I'm trying to get to something interesting here. There we go. So we have traffic flow information. So here we get some real-time traffic information. We get some real-time traffic flow items. This is saying that our real-time speed at the moment on that segment for that ID for this location ID here, which is our traffic region. So our traffic region for that this very last maneuver here, you're going to see that it goes from 0 to 771 meters, and this is the ID covering that. Then from 771 meters for the next 360 meters, this is the ID covering that section of the maneuver. In here, we have our traffic flows. We have our real-time stuff. And so this is saying our real-time speed is really 13 meters per second. Our free flow speed is this, so it's really a yellow. So there's some traffic on that segment right now. And this is the ID representing that. So basically, you take this item, you overlay it onto your maneuver for what applies there, and then you can figure out those speeds. Similarly, here, I think one of these is historical, and then we had our other traffic region from before. So we have these are the traffic regions. You apply those onto your data from before, and you can have real-time traffic there and figuring out what the traffic delay is. So you can show how long things are being impacted. So that covers everything. Let's take a look. Let's bounce back here. Presentation. So we have our traffic supports traffic-based routing. Yeah, if we want to calculate the route, we talked about that. Oh, sorry, reverse geocode. So this is for like a where am I, you want to enter in a lat long and get the address back. So, excuse me. In this case here, taking a quick look at it, we have reverse geocode here, very straightforward, enter in your coordinate, your lat long, you get back a location. So if you had a where am I or user drops a pin on a map and you have the location from GPS, let's say, you plug that in here, you hit send, and we find out that that course. Oh, there we go. Okay. So you get an address back here if you wanted to do that. I haven't tried changing this up, so I don't know what this is going to do offhand. But taking a look real quick, if I did that, so I'm going to get, yeah, that's in Poway, so 33-117, and our address where that's nearest is, it's that pin is nearest to this address. Here's a formatted address if you don't want to deal with, formatting yourself. Otherwise, you can put all the parts together right here. That covers reverse geocode. And finally here, we did have this application that I showed a little bit earlier. I'm going to go through some items in it just to kind of tie everything up. As we near the end here, I'm going to open up to questions in a couple of minutes, should there be any. And let's play with this. We can see this Maps app. So if we're searching for something, in example, this application, it'll search, you know, here, very popular Starbucks. Find some Starbucks, and there's a whole bunch of Starbucks around in that area, Long Beach and whatnot. Let's see what suggestions working there. So gas stations, okay. So a lot of suggestions coming back in this application with gas stations, Garden Grove. So we're going to look for gas stations, clicking that to search for those, then you get a whole bunch of things that are just gas stations. So it's a quick API to get a lot of to get at a lot of local places, and to, you know, those can be all presented on a map. You can get directions to those. Lots of things can be done. You can page through those results here. We get more and more of those in this application. If we wanted to get directions to something, let's try SNA LAX just as two airports. So we'll geocode both of those, or those airports will do an airport lookup. So from John Wayne Airport to Los Angeles LAX, we'll get a route to those locations. And here, yeah, then we get some bunch of steps for those. Heading north, continuing airport way. So we're leaving this one airport and driving up, taking this route and driving to this airport there. So route options, you can play with HOV lanes, avoiding highways, toll roads, get different routes, all by using LWS, which is everything you need here and everything that we've shown. So these features, functions can be added to your app very similarly. I think that covers it. I'll go to the Q&A section now, see if that opens this up for any questions at all. We can cover those. So thank you for waiting till the end. Let me find the Q&A stuff. And all of this. Okay, so I see we have some questions here already. Hey guys, so let's see, first question, thank you for the congratulations. Where might we find the API and WSDL function description? So hopefully I've answered that in some of the definitions there. So hopefully through the information that you saw in the links, I think it'll be really important. Let me paste that here in case it wasn't, you know, very, very obvious maybe. So I'll paste the information right here. And this is effectively all you need, really. So so there's our links, and that's the basis there. So you, this is the endpoint. You can get all the documentation from there. And then as far as the credentials go, let me show that. Let me paste those here as well. So that this is pretty much all you need. This is the partner, this is the PID. Oh, I have to click the answer here. So I'm basically answering these individually, so sorry guys. Let's see. Send. Yeah, that worked. And then the API key. And that worked as well. So yeah, hopefully that covers most of the questions. There also, you can send an email at any time to ltksupport@telecomsys.com. That will get to myself and Todd and a few others actually. You can send anything there for these questions just in case you need any support at all. Send questions there. We'll send you an API key out, which is the same one as I pasted those asking here. So everybody should have received that now. Also, you could send out you know, an email in case anything does get answered. Plus, we'll be there on site at the event to help out with anything. As far as any fees related to using the system, at this time, that's probably more a question for business development, and so that would be something we could tackle in the, via email. At the moment, this is free to use for anybody, you know, using the hackathon. There's no real limit limits on anything for this. The environment we set up is segmented off and relegated just for hackathon use. So feel free to play with it and use it. And should there be, you know, desire to use this, outside of the hackathon, we would definitely be on site and can take questions and things via that email address and can field those and get you responses quickly. So with that, if there are any other questions, you know, fire away. And other than that, that looks to close it out. So I want to thank everybody for attending this today, sitting through it for the entire duration. I hopefully shared some details with you of where you can go about and get more information and go about building this in these items into your application. We're very, very excited. We'll both be there on site, as well as our judge, and Mark Goddard will be there. So be sure to be nice to Mark and then put a good word into you. But also use our application, use our APIs, and you'll definitely be considered for that $5,000 Accelerator Award, which we're all very excited about and can't wait to get out there and see people using it. So thank you guys very much, and send any questions you have to that email address, and we will see you in Vegas.
Yeah, we can't wait to see what you will do.
All right. Very cool. Bye, guys.
Bye.